And then I come to page 9. In the second block of this masterclass, we were talking about 12% people in our city without a qualification for the labor market. A small part in Rotterdam is 25%, it's much higher. So we are a privileged city, we have only a small population which needs some kind of government support for a human life, dignified life, but still we have the challenge to give them opportunities. And then we are at risk. You see, let's first have a look at the top photograph. The Hudson vessel in New York. Any one of you been there? Just two. Huh? It's closed. Why it's closed? Bastian, why it's closed?
It's people jump off
it. Yeah. People jump off. Suicide. But why was it built? Well, why was it built? New York is, of course, capital of mankind. New York is the top city. And all other cities are some kind of small New York. But what is happening in New York and happening in San Francisco and in London and in Paris, maybe in Amsterdam and maybe also in Leiden, the cities are getting closed enclaves for the happy few. New York is affordable for tourists and for Russian oil billionaires. And you are now looking at the Hudson Yards. The Hudson Yards is a vast real estate program on the Hudson River with very expensive condos, apartments for foreigners. And there's just one public convenience, just one concession for the public functioning of that part, new part of the city. And that's the Hudson vessel. It's a staircase you can climb. What is the purpose of this staircase? It costs $90 million. What is the purpose of this staircase? What do tourists do when they arrive at the top of a staircase? What do they do? Photo, they make selfies. So this is the first building in the world built to make selfies. So you are the capital of mankind, capital of world culture. You have been the torchbearer for mankind for 1.5 centuries. And now you build a staircase for selfies. And the Americans call New York City a hollow city. It's not keeping up to its promises as emancipation machine for newcomers. It's not making true the beautiful text on the Statue of Liberty, give me your Harold Poor. No, it's a reserve for the happy few and for the tourists. And if you are creative and you are pioneering, what do you have to look for in New York? Nothing. And the Americans know that. And the cities nearby New York know it also. So they are now trying to get some of the talents to their own cities. So New York is not functioning anymore in terms of being an emancipation machine. And now you're going to the other photo, the escalators of Medellin. Again, we're looking to stairs. So any one of you have been to Medellin? Yes, I see. One hand. You have been there. Great. Welcome. You are a reporter, I suppose. Yeah. Let's talk about Medellin for a second. When have you been to Medellin?
Do you want me to say something?
Yeah, about Medellin.
Okay, about Medellin. The staircases that run up to the mountains, and it's easier for the people. The higher you live, the poorer you are in Medellin. So it's much easier for the people that live high up in the mountains to get to the city so they can make money.
Yeah. Thank you very much. That's exactly true. I said at the beginning of this masterclass that Medellin is, for urban scientists, a very interesting city. In 1990, Medellin was a no-go city. It was the capital of the cocaine gangs in Colombia. It was terribly dangerous, and it was a very poor and violent city. And in 2015, in just 25 years, we're talking about Leiden as a comeback city in just 1.5 generation. Our colleagues in Medellin did it even faster, in 25 years. In 2015, Medellin had lowered its murder rate with 90%. And they lowered the poverty with 75%. So in just 25 years, great advances. And how did they do that? Let's repeat one thing which we often forget. They had integral, competent politicians and city officials. It always starts with non-corruption, with sound relations. If you make an appointment, people should keep themselves to that appointment. No bribes, no envelopes. And Medellin was blessed with a generation of that kind of politicians and city officials. But they made other choices, and they made the choice to build the escalators because the poor living in the mountains lost 2 hours a day walking into the valley for daily work. And they decided to build the escalator, so it took only 10 minutes to come down from the slopes into a valley. And they did that in a way which activated the population. So alongside the escalators, market squares developed. And on the top of the escalators, the city decided to build libraries. And libraries are not necessarily collections of books. But in Medellin, libraries are places where it is safe, also for women, to go after dark. It's dark at 6 in the tropics. And to go there and study and to use internet. It's light, it's safe. And after spending an evening in the library, you can go on higher on the slopes to your own home. So building the escalators changed the spatial structure of a city enormously. In just a few years' time, the poor population came into movement. They started to self-mobilize. They started to self-develop them. And that's incredibly clever. If you make a trigger, not the government is taking care of the people. No, the government has made a policy, and our people are taking care of themselves. And they found a source of self-motivation and of working. And that's incredibly clever to have that kind of look at the city. So two staircases. And for our cities, knowledge hubs, it's a challenge to find mechanisms to bring our poorer quarters in contact with our richer quarters and to build opportunities for self-emancipation for our poor fellow citizens. That's the second challenge.